Hi, I'm Steve Sandler, the Managing Director and CTO at PicoTest. In today's video, I'll show you how to optimize the selection, placement, and mounting of decoupling capacitors. This is the fifth video in the How to Design for Power Integrity series. If you haven't watched the prior videos yet, you might want to go ahead and do so. Decoupling capacitors are used to keep the power rail transient voltages within allowable limits. Improper decoupling capacitor selection can result in ringing with two potential responses. The AC forced response is larger than the natural step response by a factor of the resonant Q. Maintaining a flat impedance with the minimum number of capacitors is a fundamental goal. In this example, both the original and optimized decoupling meet the target impedance requirements, but the optimum solution uses 40% fewer capacitors. The starting point for optimizing the decoupling is the determination of a reasonable target impedance requirement. The target impedance is determined by the allowed voltage transient and the expected transient load current. In this video, I'll show you the number one cause of excessive ringing on the power rail and how to determine the decoupling capacitors to achieve flat impedance. I'll show you how the capacitor connections and printed circuit board stackup interact. And finally, I'll show you how to use the ADS decap optimizer to minimize the number of decoupling capacitors. And at the end of the video, I'll even share my ADS workspace with you so that you can use it for your own projects right away. Let's start with a simple example using this flat impedance voltage regulator demo board. The impedance measurement of this VRM shows a flat resistance of 20 milliohms, followed by an inductance of 6 nanohenries at higher frequencies. While I prefer to include a complete VRM model, if your simulator only accepts resistor and inductor equivalents, these are the numbers you would use. Parallel inductors and capacitors can resonate. The 6 nanohenries of this VRM can resonate with the decoupling capacitors if they aren't properly selected. The peak resonant impedance is a function of the resonant Q. Flat impedance doesn't have a peak and therefore doesn't result in ringing. I discussed this resonance in great detail in the first video, Finding Power Delivery Noise Problems. Finding the right capacitor to cancel the inductance of the VRM and deliver flat impedance is done by setting the parallel impedance of the VRM and the decoupling capacitor equal to the desired target impedance. This results in the simple equation, C is equal to L of the VRM divided by R target squared. Adding printed circuit board parasitics shows that the L total will increase and require more decoupling capacitance. So be sure to use the total resistance and inductance when calculating the decoupling capacitance. We can also visually see the required capacitance by creating an equal and opposite impedance to cancel the inductance. Inductor impedance increases at 6 dB per octave, while capacitor impedance decreases at 6 dB per octave with an intersection close to the target impedance. Here's an example of connecting a VRM to a small printed circuit board plane with solder pads for decoupling capacitors. SMA connectors are also attached for measurement of the impedance at both the VRM and the load. The power plane simulation shows that the plane inductance is approximately 7 nanohenries, and the resistance is approximately 3 milliohms. The measurement is in excellent agreement with the simulation. The connector pins also add inductance. In this case, the inductance of the two connector pins is approximately 2 nanohenries. Adding the VRM, printed circuit board, and connector pins results in a total of 24 milliohms and 15 nanohenries. This total is what's used to calculate the decoupling capacitance. The measured VRM resistance is 20 milliohms. Adding 1 milliohm for the pins and 3 milliohms for the printed circuit board plane results in a total of 24 milliohms to reach the load. The VRM inductance alone is 6 nanohenries, and adding the 7 nanohenries for the printed circuit board plane and 2 nanohenries for the connector pins results in 15 nanohenries seen by the load at the end of the power plane. Again, this measurement is in very good agreement with the simulator results. Applying our simple equation using the L and R at the end of the plane results in a decoupling capacitor of approximately 16 microfarads with an ESR of 24 milliohms. Here you can see the 15 nanohenries at the load without the decoupling capacitors in the red trace. The blue trace includes two 10 microfarad 50 milliohm controlled ESR capacitors. While the capacitance is slightly higher and the ESR is slightly low, the decoupling capacitor flattens the impedance to 4 MHz, reducing the high frequency inductance from 15 nanohenries to less than 1 nanohenry. The measurement of the VRM planes and decoupling capacitors is in very good agreement with the simulation within the tolerances of the capacitors. The high frequency inductance is greatly reduced, but still exhibits about 875 picohenries. The decoupling capacitors also have parasitic inductance that becomes dominant at higher frequencies. The two parallel decoupling capacitors present a combined series inductance of 875 picohenries. In the same way that we canceled the VRM inductance, we can cancel the decoupling capacitor inductance. Using the same equation and substituting the decoupling capacitor inductance, we substitute 875 picohenries and 24 milliohms. That requires approximately 1.5 microfarads of capacitance with 24 milliohms of ESR. Using multiple parallel capacitors will reduce the inductance, but the most efficient way to minimize the inductance of the capacitors is to improve the connections to the buried plane or planes. The inductance of the ceramic capacitor itself is mostly a function of its size, and these small capacitors are approximately 300 picohenries. The rest is due to the circuit board connections or mount. This example shows two identical capacitors mounted to a two-layer FR4 printed circuit board. The blue board is a 63 mil dielectric, while the green board is an 8 mil dielectric. The same Gerber files were used to produce both boards. Each board has two identical capacitors mounted. One uses two ground vias, and the other uses a small island with 14 vias. The additional vias reduce the inductance, and so does the thinner circuit board dielectric. The added vias are most effective when the ground plane is further from the surface. Paralleling capacitors is a bit tricky. The physical location and the measurement points can result in some odd behavior. This simple printed circuit board has five side-by-side capacitors mounted. You might expect that paralleling five identical capacitors will result in five times the capacitance with 1/5 the resistance and inductance. But due to small parasitic inductance in the circuit board, the parallel capacitors won't necessarily act the way you expect. This EM simulation shows that while the capacitance is five times greater, the resistance and inductance are only halved and are not the same as a simple lumped spice simulation. Using five decade space capacitors also exhibits unexpected behavior. Due to the small parasitic printed circuit board inductance, the impedance looks different depending on the direction of the impedance measurement, while the lumped spice model looks the same. This clearly illustrates why we need to use EM simulation for assessing decoupling. There are three basic schemes for using parallel decoupling capacitors. These two, courtesy of István Novák, compare the three schemes. Flat impedance is the best solution with 10 millivolts per amp. Multipole refers to the use of multiple carefully chosen valued capacitors to obtain a somewhat flat impedance. This is second best at 16 millivolts per amp. And paralleling many of the same capacitors results in a big V, which is the worst at 21 millivolts per amp. In a multipole design, it's difficult to select the various capacitors required to obtain a reasonably flat response. The required values are often unrealistic, and even if you succeed, capacitor tolerances will significantly degrade the result. Even in the best case, the voltage transient will be 60% larger than a flat impedance design. The performance of the big V is even worse, with a transient voltage of more than double that of the flat impedance solution. The big V is better behaved with regards to tolerance, but the resulting high Q of the high frequency inductance will likely increase the amplitude of the resonance on die. Flat impedance decoupling results in the smallest voltage transient and performs well even with tolerances considered. After using the simple equation to determine the decoupling capacitors as we've done previously, you can use a full 3D EM model of the printed circuit board parasitics and run the ADS PI Pro decap optimization tool to minimize the number of capacitors. Here is an example design using an actual high-density circuit board where both the original and optimized design met the target impedance, but the flatter impedance design reduces the quantity of capacitors by 40%. The optimized PDN can be combined with an accurate VRM model as shown in the fourth video, DC to DC converter modeling and simulation, for an end-to-end PI ecosystem simulation. Combining the accurate state-based average model with the printed circuit board and decoupling model enables small signal AC and large signal transient harmonic balance to run simultaneously in minutes and not hours. And remember, this could happen to you if you don't take a look at the PDN impedance and optimize the decoupling capacitors. These multiple resonances can combine into voltage rogue waves, as I shared in the first video of the series, finding power delivery noise problems. In this video, I showed you how parallel resonances lead to significant voltage ringing on the power rail. I showed you how to calculate the decoupling capacitance for your circuit board, how to minimize the impact of the circuit board parasitics. And finally, I showed you how to use an automated optimizer to meet the target impedance requirement for your circuit board using the minimum number of decoupling capacitors. Now you can download my workspace that includes the simulations I created for this video by clicking on the link in the description of this video or by typing in this URL.